what I see. Do you see what I see? Well, I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under.
Glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Say, yes, I am. All right. Let's sing it loud. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice of the same old life, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. Come on, church. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, yes, he is. We've all searched for the light of day, dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run the things we know just ain't right. Show of hands, has he been good to you this week? Has God been good to you? Amen. If he has, let's sing it loud. I may not know what tomorrow holds, but I know one thing for sure. Good Lord, I've got a good Lord. And every day, every step of the way, it's you who open the door. Good Lord, I've got a good Lord. Say good Lord. I've got a good Lord. Yeah. When I look back, I can see that it's you who met my needs. Every time and every moment you were holding, even the smallest details of my life, and I can testify. Oh, you never left.
how you saved me, how you took a million wrongs, made them right.
You made them right.
Yes, you made them right.
You made them right. Oh,
and it's crazy how you raised me from 6 feet under shame.
Good morning, church. It is so good to see all of you here today. As we do this envelope fundraiser for the kids, I'm reminded of just how blessed we are. Because of your generosity, we can send kids that couldn't go to camp before because of you guys. So thank you. I appreciate it, and I know that they appreciate it as well. You can continue to give in the drop box in the lobby, the giving walls, or tap to pay as you come in here, and give online or by texting the number on the screen. As we move into our worship through communion, our time of worship through communion, I want us to be reminded of what Jesus did for us for 33 years on this earth. Mark 10:45 says, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." He came to serve, not to be served. Let that sink in a little bit. The Son of Man came to serve, not to be served. And I'm guilty. I'm guilty of allowing my comfort zones and my conveniences get in my way of serving others. You know, instead of helping the lady on the scooter in Walmart, I get a little frustrated because she's getting in my way of my convenience. Maybe instead of me getting frustrated, I should go help her, ask her if she needs me to get anything off the shelves for her. And if Jesus served, I mean, that's enough for me. That's enough to set aside my comfort zone and my conveniences to get up and go serve. And after Jesus served, he gave his life for us. He also passed along his mission to us as well, to go save the one. So as we take communion today, remember that sacrifice, but also remember Jesus served too. The cup that you were handed as you walked in here today is a representation of that sacrifice. Under that top tab is the bread, which represents the body of Jesus. Under that second tab is the juice that represents the blood of Jesus. Here in a second, I will pray and you can partake. Father God, we come before you this morning, and we thank you for you just sacrificing your one and only Son for us. Father, I pray that if we have built up walls and that if we don't serve, that we will begin to serve and be more like Jesus every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Church, would you stand with us? We'll continue to worship. One of my favorite things that I get to do here working at this church is on Mondays and Thursdays, I go over here to the preschool and I sing with a bunch of my little friends, and we get rowdy and we sing, we jump, we stomp, we do all kinds of fun stuff. I get them real wound up and then I leave. This is a new song that we've started doing in there, and they're catching on to it and singing it loud. You know, Jesus told us that having a childlike faith was important, and those kids just shouted out, and I'm going to admit, sometimes they call me Jesus, so I think they're a little confused, and I don't correct them. No, I'm just kidding. But they sing this loud, so let's sing it like a preschooler. Come on. A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus. Let me hear you, church. That's right. All right, let's do it again. A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus. Nice and loud. Try my best, but just don't get it right. Where I talk the talk that I don't want, miss the moments right before my eyes. Oh, somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held, when I just can't past myself. Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more. Now there's no denying I have changed. I've been saved from who I used to be. Thank God for that, amen. But even at my best, I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Yeah, yeah. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a can't see past myself. Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Oh, to feed the beggar on the street. Look at
we're already in our third week of Life One Mission, and this week is all about serve. You know, sometimes loving people is super easy. This picture right here, this is my sweet little girl, Holland, and she is the easiest thing in the world to love. She's young, she's sweet, she thinks that her dad is Superman. She doesn't think that there's anything in the world that I can't do. But let's be honest, sometimes loving people is extremely hard. Today, I don't want to talk about the rainbows and the sunshine, but instead, I want to talk about the fact that people are a mess. People, they're needy, they're clingy, they're selfish, they're bossy, they're disrespectful, and I'm just talking about you. But if you're like me, you've probably got this list of people who are tough to love. And if you've got an extremely long list, you're probably the person that's really tough to love. But if we're going to be able to live our life on mission, we've got to learn to love people, even the ones that are difficult. And I think that the tougher to love people, they fall into one of two categories. You got the ones that are messy, the ones that are just a little bit complicated. And then you got the ones that are mean, the ones that you just simply, you don't like. But let's dive in. Let's see what Jesus has to say about these people. Let's look at Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 and 39. He says, "You've heard the law that says the punishment must match the injury, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, offer the other cheek also." And so Jesus, he's telling us, there's going to be evil, disrespectful people in your life, but I don't want you to react to them. No, I want you to love them. He says, there's going to be people in your life that are going to cheat. There's going to be people who lie, people that want to take from you, but I want you to love them. Let's look at verses 43 through 45. He continues on. It says, "You've heard the law that says love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. And in that way, you'll be acting as true children of your Father in heaven." And back in the time of Jesus, the Jews were living under Roman law. And according to Roman law, a Roman soldier could go up to a Jewish person and say, "Hey, I've got this load that needs to be carried, and I want you to carry it." And it doesn't matter how heavy the load is. It doesn't matter what the Jewish person would have been doing. By law, the Israelite would have to pick this load up, and they would have to carry it for a mile. And the Jews, they hated this law. They hated this law almost as much as they hated the Romans. But Jesus was trying to make it clear to them. He says, guys, there's going to be arrogant, bossy, lazy, entitled, degrading people, and I want you to go the extra mile for them. And whenever you go beyond what's expected of you for others, people know that the only reason that you're doing it is because of love. And I know how hard this is. None of us want to love the people that we don't want to love. But when we don't love, what we do is we're missing out on the heart of Jesus. In Luke chapter 10, in verses 25 through 26, it says that one day, an expert in religious law, he stood up to test Jesus by asking him a question. He said, "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus replied, "Well, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" So this guy asked the question. He says, "What do I have to do to inherit eternal life?" And this question all on its own is wrong, because there is nothing that we can do to inherit eternal life. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. But Jesus is going to give him a pass on that. Instead, he's just going to simply say, "Well, what scripture have to say?" And this guy responds with Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 5, which says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind." And then he goes on and he quotes Leviticus 19:18, which says, "And love your neighbor as yourself." And so this man, he knows the answer. And Jesus says, "Yep, that's right. And if you'll do those things, you'll inherit eternal life." But this guy, like so many of us, he just doesn't know when to quit talking. And in verse 29, it says, the man wanted to justify his actions, and so he asked Jesus, "And who's my neighbor?" And have you ever met somebody that knows the answer, but it just doesn't seem like they really understand the question? This guy wants a ticket into heaven, but Jesus wants to show him how to find real and eternal life. And so Jesus, he's going to do what he typically does when somebody is having a tough time getting it. He's going to tell a story. In verse 30, it says, Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of all of his clothes, they beat him up, and they left him half dead beside the road. Now, anybody that was listening to Jesus tell this story, they would have known a few things just right off the bat. First, they know that this guy's alone. And second, they know that if this guy is going from Jerusalem down to Jericho, they know that that's not a good road. That's not a safe road to be traveling alone. It is a very dangerous stretch of road. So this man, he's all alone on this dangerous road, and then out of nowhere, it says he was blindsided. It says that they stripped him of his clothes. And they didn't just rob him either. No, they beat him. And they kicked this guy while he was down, and he was bleeding. And from what we can tell, he was beaten up pretty badly. And he was left for dead with zero chance of making it on his own. Well, Jesus, he keeps telling his story. And in verses 31 and 32, it says, by chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed over to the other side of the road and he passed him by. A temple assistant also walked by and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Now, this priest, he would have been like a preacher. And he sees this guy on the side of the road, and he decides that he's going to walk around this guy. And then you've got the temple assistant. And the temple assistant would have been like a life group's pastor. And when this temple assistant, when he sees this man laying on the side of the road, he too goes over to the other side. Now, I want to pause right there and say that I am shocked by the behavior of this preacher. But doesn't that sound like a typical life group's pastor? Now, this priest, he's a guy that does a lot of great stuff for people. The temple assistant also would have been somebody that was always going out of their way to help others. And so they're both supposedly these really great guys, but they both moved over to the other side of the road. And it's not even a big road. They literally would have had to almost jump over this guy in order to get to the other side. And so two guys come who know better than to walk by. And they should have stopped and helped, but they do nothing. Why? Well, I don't know for sure, but if these guys are wired like me, they were probably focused on all the different things that they needed to get done that day. Something in them thought, oh man, this is going to take a lot of time, and I've got so much going on. I don't really have time for this. Surely there's going to be somebody else that's going to be coming pretty soon, and they can stop and help them. Or maybe they thought, another guy on the side of the road? We can't stop and help every single person that we see. Or maybe instead of focusing on this man, they were instead more worried about their own safety. Maybe they were looking around thinking, I hope that we don't end up getting jumped too. Or maybe they saw this guy that was badly beaten and he didn't have any clothes on, and they realized, this is going to be a job. This is going to cost me. This is going to be draining, and I don't know if I have this in me. I don't even know where I should start. Now, we don't know why they didn't stop, but isn't it interesting that Jesus grabs two people that everybody knows shouldn't walk by without helping? And maybe they felt guilty. But guilt is never going to get us to the place where Jesus wants us, especially when it comes to loving people. We are not fulfilling our mission as witnesses, I think, too often because we're way too busy and we don't see people with compassion. And Jesus, he goes on in verse 33, and it says, and then a despised Samaritan came along. And the Samaritans and the Jews, they were two groups of people that really hated each other. Jesus is using a very real enemy for the Jews. Using a Samaritan in the story to be the hero, it'd be like trying to honor a Chicago Cub player at a Cardinals convention. It is not going to go over well. And Jesus knows that. Then Jesus, he describes what happens next. He says in verse 33, when he saw the man, he had compassion for him. And remember, the Samaritan, he's not the first person to see this guy. The other two guys, they saw him too, but when they did, they were focused on something else. But this guy, this Samaritan, he sees him and he says, I know who you are. I know that we're not supposed to like each other. We're not supposed to get along, but I can't unsee you. I can't just walk by and pretend that everything is going to be okay, like this didn't happen. No, instead, I'm going to have eyes today for the one that Jesus has put in my path. It says that he had compassion when he saw the man. And what's so interesting about this word compassion, the only time that it's used in the Bible is to describe the way that Jesus saw people. And so Jesus wants us to know that not only did he see this man, he saw him the exact same way that Jesus sees people. There was something that moved deep down inside of this man that allowed God to move through him. And in verse 34, it goes on and says, going over to him. And the literal translation for that is, he went down to him. This guy had to meet him where he was at. He said to himself, I can't help you from a distance. I'm not going to just pray for you as I walk by. I've got to get close, even if it means that things are going to get messy. The Bible says he got off his donkey and he went to work. And then the rest of verse 34, it says the Samaritan, he soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and he bandaged them. And then he put the man on his own donkey and he took him to an inn where he took care of him. This guy, he said, I can't just bandage you up and hope that everything works out okay. No, I've got to get you on a different path because this road that you're on right now, this road is dangerous. I've got to get you to a place where you can be healed. And the only way that I'm going to be able to make that happen is to get my hands dirty. In verse 35, it says, the next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. And if his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you more the next time I'm here. This Samaritan, this guy, he wasn't doing this to clear his conscience. He was doing it because he loved the man and he was going to take care of him no matter what the cost might be. And then Jesus, he looks at this expert in religious law and he says to him, he says, which one of these 3 guys do you think was a neighbor to the man that was beat up and robbed? In verse 37, it says, the man replied, the one who showed him mercy. And then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. And Jesus, he's called all of us to love others, even the difficult people. And we know that sometimes they're messy. We know that sometimes they can be mean, but he wants us to go the extra mile to love every single person. But I think loving like the Good Samaritan, it starts by choosing which person in the story you most identify with. Because I used to really relate well to the priest and to the temple assistant, because in my job, I do a lot of different things that people would consider to be nice for others. I do things like serving. I do things like teaching the Bible. I tithe. I do stuff. But when I see people that I know that I need to stop for, I usually don't stop. And it's not that I never stop. It's just usually when I do stop, I do it because of guilt. Or I stop because I feel like that's something that I'm supposed to do. But honestly, that never changes me. It actually makes me feel more guilty. It makes me feel like I'm terrible at this thing. Every time that you do something for the kingdom of God and it's motivated by guilt, it's not going to get you where you think it is. And there's been times where I've tried to relate to the Good Samaritan. You know, if guilt's not going to work, then I'm just going to try harder. And so I can make this list of things that I need to do, but I still fall short. I never change by just trying harder. But maybe Jesus is telling us this story so that we would recognize that the only way that we can unlock the Samaritan's heart is to realize that we're the guy that's on the side of the road. Am I the only one in here at one point in life knew that I was on a road that wasn't good for me? Where I knew that I probably shouldn't be there, but I just never thought that this could happen to me. I never saw it coming. And then all of a sudden, I'm the one that's on the side of the road. I'm the one that's broken down. I'm the one that's beat up. And does anybody else in those seasons feel dumb and ashamed and helpless and just feel like you're hanging on by a thread, where it just feels like all these people are walking by you and they don't care? Does anybody remember what it was like the very first time that you realized that Jesus sees you? Does anybody remember what it was like whenever you felt his compassion for you? To be overwhelmed by the fact that he came down to this earth because he wanted to meet us where we were at? And it's not a good place. He picked us up in all of our shame and all of our embarrassment. We were a complete mess. And he looked at us and he said, I don't care. I still love you. I am not the Good Samaritan. I'm the guy that's on the side of the road. And I think whenever this guy on the side of the road started to realize that, it became really tough for him to walk past people every single day who were angry and hurt and broken and abused. The ones who have been left on the side of the road. The ones who are arrogant and proud. Because when you remember what it's like to be on the side of the road, you're willing to do whatever it takes to help people, to help get them in front of Jesus. So as we close, I want to give you 3 action steps that I believe are necessary to develop this heart for serving others. I think the first thing that we do, the first action step that we've got to take is we've got to stop. We've got to stop, because I think that the greatest hindrance to Jesus' mission is his workers' busyness. We don't have time to stop. But if we would stop, and if we would look around, we would start to recognize that there are so many people who are hurting. There are so many people who have needs. You got to realize these people, they don't have a shot where they're at. We've got to get them somewhere else. We've got to get them off this path. We've got to get them into a place where they can really be healed, a place where they can find community. We've got to help them. Second thing that I think we have to do is we have to drop. Drop. You've got to inconvenience yourself. Like the Bible says, you got to get off your donkey. In California, I see where you're going there. In California, in the early 1990s, there was about 600 lawyer hopefuls that were taking their state bar exam at the Pasadena Convention Center when all of a sudden a 50-year-old man that was taking the test, he had a massive heart attack. Now, only two out of the 600 test takers stopped to help this man, guys by the name of John Leslie and Eunice Morgan. And these guys, they administered CPR until the paramedics arrived, and then they resumed taking their exam. But citing policy, the test supervisor refused to allow the guys additional time to make up for the 40 minutes that they spent helping out the victim. In fact, the State Bar Office of Admission, they actually backed this decision, and they said, if these two want to be lawyers, then they should learn a lesson about priorities. Now, this story, it was covered in the San Francisco newspapers. It was covered by the local news media. And as you can imagine, the outcry was loud. And eventually, they forced the state board to change their mind, and these guys were allowed to retake the test, and the additional time was granted. But think about that. Only two people out of 600 cared enough to do something. Matthew 25, in verses 37 through 40, it says, "Then these righteous ones will reply, 'Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? Or a stranger and show you hospitality? Or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?' And the king will say, 'I tell you the truth, when you did it for one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it for me.'" Pastor Todd Clark, he said, "There is no traffic jam on the extra mile." Okay, service opportunities are not crowded. Our church's biggest challenge is going to be for us to move beyond the surface. Because oftentimes, we have a tough time serving others. And I think the reason is if it involves a long-term commitment, we're not interested. We'll help out with the quick fixes, but if it's something that's going to take a little bit longer, or if it's something that's going to cost a little bit more time or energy, or if it's something that it's going to be ongoing, it's really difficult for us to say, "Yeah, I'll help out with that." Well, we got to stop, we got to drop, and then the last thing we got to do is roll. No, I'm just kidding. I was stuck between that and shut them down, open up shop. Anybody? Last thing, stop, drop, and share. And what was it that the Samaritan shared? He shared the stuff that he had. It was just some oil. It was some wine. It was just a little bit of money. He helped pay for the guy's medical expenses. This guy didn't empty out his bank account. It was simply just stop, drop, and share. And God has given us everything that we have. So why can't we do that? Why can't we stop, drop, and share? Why can't we do those things? James 3, 15 and 16 is so convicting. It says, "Suppose that you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say, 'Goodbye, have a good day, stay warm and eat well.' But then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do?" George Bernard Shaw, he said it this way. He said, "The worst sin that we can commit toward our fellow creatures, it's not to hate them, but to be indifferent towards them." And I highly doubt that on our drive home today, we're going to pull into our subdivisions and see a half-beaten-to-death man in the subdivision. If that happens, call the cops and then help. But what is the most practical thing that you can do for somebody in your life that has a clear need? I think the best thing that you could possibly do is just be a person that serves. Just be a good neighbor, to be a witness. Stop and have a cup of coffee with them. Just listen to what they need to say. A lot of times people just want to be heard. But how are we supposed to know what somebody's needs are if we're not willing to connect with them? As a church, we're never going to succeed in reaching the one until people start to understand that we care. In the early church, they were so effective when it came to this. They were such effective witnesses for Jesus because they understood this. There was a Roman emperor by the name of Hadrian, and this guy was a pagan empire. He was a guy who wanted nothing to do with Jesus, but one time he said this about Christians. He said, "Look at how they love one another. See how they love one another. They never fail to help the widows. They save orphans from those who would hurt them. And if they have something, they give freely to those who have nothing. If they see a stranger, they take him home as though he was a brother." And who wouldn't want to be a part of that? Who doesn't want to be a part of that? That's why Christianity blew up, and in just 3 centuries, it took over the entire world up to the point where Constantine was the emperor. He too became a Christian. Now, why would that happen? Well, it's because they loved each other. And notice the difference between how the early church worked, and nowadays we can drive around town and we see bumper stickers that says, God, please save me from your followers. What's happened to us? Jesus said, go and do the same. And that's the challenge. Let's pray. God, there's people who are tough to love. And I pray, God, that as a church, we'll be different. That we would start to see people with your eyes. That we wouldn't see people as an inconvenience, or we wouldn't see people as draining. But instead, we would see them as a child of God. That you would give us your eyes to love the lost. God, to reach the lost. We want to be a life-changing church. And I pray that you would use us to reach those who don't know you. God, use us in a big way. We thank you for all that you're already doing. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
If you'll stand with us, church, continue to worship.
Yes.
it out loud. Lord, I need you. 'Cause Lord, I need you.
Next steps team, you guys can go ahead and head up front. I have a couple announcements for you guys. Our high school and middle school students are out front doing the envelope fundraiser. If you guys are able, we'd really appreciate it if you went out there and stopped by and checked it out for us. First time guest, if you guys are new here, we'd love to meet you out at the Next Steps area in the lobby. We have a gift to say thanks for checking us out. And this Next Steps team is here to pray with you if you have any prayer needs. Hope you guys have a great Sunday.